Good morning. And welcome to Redeemer Evangelical Lutheran Church, God's house, your home. Welcome home on this third Sunday of Advent. And actually, how things go with our church, this is our last Sunday of Advent. Next week will be our children's service, although it is a condensed version of it. The kids aren't singing as much. We are still following the same order, the same lessons of that Sunday. We're going to hear about the Savior's birth. But for today, we're going to focus on Christ, who is still yet to come, as we anticipate his arrival on Christmas. And we're going to look at God's gift that he has given to the world. With that, we sing the opening hymn, The Advent of Our King. I ask you, please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin. For faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do, you should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In his great mercy, God made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through his called servant. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life. Hear our prayer, O Lord. For the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you. Hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ have mercy.
For patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of heaven as we await your return, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of life, Live in us that we may live for you. Amen. We sing and praise Hosanna to the coming Lord. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and come, take away the burden of our sins, and make us ready for the celebration of your birth, that we may receive you in joy and serve you always. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for the reading of our first lesson. Our first lesson is taken from from 2 Samuel chapter 7. God is saying to the prophet Nathan, "You are also to say the following to my servant David. This is what the Lord of armies says. I took you from the pasture, from following sheep, to be ruler over my people. Over Israel, I have been with you wherever you went. I have cut off all your enemies from before you. I will make your reputation great, like that of the great ones on the earth. I will set up a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them there. They will dwell there, and they will not be disturbed again. Violent men will not afflict them again, as they did at the beginning. And ever since the day I appointed judges over my people Israel, I will give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord also declares to you that the Lord himself will make a house for you. When your days are complete and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up after you your seed, who will come from your own body. I will establish his kingdom. He will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he sins, I will discipline him with a rod used by men and with blows of the sons of men. My faithful mercy will not depart from him, as I removed it from Saul, whom I removed to make room for you. Your house will stand firm, and your kingdom will endure forever before you. Your throne will be established forever." This is the word of our Lord. We continue by singing Psalm 89. We sing the refrain together, and we speak the rest responsively.
At the works of your hands, O Lord, I lift up my voice in song, I sing for joy.
I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. I will declare that your love stands firm forever. The heavens praise your wonders, O Lord.
At the works of your hands, O Lord, I lift up my voice in song, I sing for joy.
O Lord, God Almighty, who is like you? Blessed are those who have learned to acclaim you. They rejoice in your name all day long. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
At the works of your hands, O Lord, I lift up my voice in song, I sing for joy.
Our second lesson, which will also be the basis for our sermon today, is Romans chapter 16, the final last words of Paul in his letter to the Romans. Now to him who is able to strengthen you, according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was veiled in silence for long ages past, but now has been revealed through the prophetic scriptures and made known to all the Gentiles in keeping with the command of the eternal God, resulting in the obedience of faith. To God, who alone is wise, be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. This is the word of our Lord. Alleluia. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
I ask that you please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel for today is taken from Luke chapter 1. Glory be to you, O Lord. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin pledged in marriage to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But she was greatly troubled by the statement and was wondering what kind of greeting this could be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, because you have found favor with God. Listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Listen, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, even though she was called barren, and this is her sixth month, for nothing will be impossible for God. Then Mary said, "See, I am the Lord's servant. May it happen to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we sing the hymn of the day, "O Come, O Come, Emmanuel." Please note that after the second stanza, the children are invited, if they so please, to come forward for a children's devotion.
Thank you.
Children can come forward for the children's devotion. All of you guys sit over here, sit on the chairs or on the steps over here, wherever you like. We're going to stay on this side. May have to go a little over here. Well, it's good to see so many of you guys here. You guys want to sit? You guys make some room there? You can move this. Yeah, that's fine. There you go. One more. Okay. Well, it's good to see all you guys here. How's everyone doing? Good. Glad to hear. We are getting ready for Christmas, as you can see. Each week, I feel like if you've been coming, you would see see the church get a little bit more and more prepared for Christmas. Last week, we didn't even have the Christmas tree up yet. Did you know that?
Yes.
We finally get the Christmas tree up. That's good. Is there something else that's missing with a Christmas tree? Yeah, right? At your house, do you guys have some presents under the tree right now? Yeah? Some do, some don't. Usually there's presents under the tree, right? Yeah, and they're wrapped. Do you guys want to open those presents? All right, you want to see what's inside? You want to open them because you know that it's going to be awesome, right? You know that that whatever is underneath there, that once you open it, you're going to see that's going to be something. You got a lot of presents? And it's gonna be, you open it and you're gonna see that's great, right? And you just wanna play with it and have lots of fun. Well, we didn't plan this necessarily, but there is one gift that's kind of under the tree. You guys see it? Well, you guys are pointing to it, I think. Okay, we have the nativity scene over there. We have Mary and Joseph, we have wise men, and we have little baby Jesus there. Do you know Jesus was the first gift given on Christmas? A gift given by God? God very early on said, I'm going to send a Savior. I'm going to send Jesus to save the world from sin. And it was like a wrapped gift. And people had to wait and wait and wait and wait all until the first Christmas when Jesus was born. And there the gift was fully given. Jesus came to the world to save you and everyone from sin. What a great gift God has given us. He's given us his son, Jesus, to save us from sin. Let's pray, giving thanks to God for his gift. Oh God, thank you for giving us the greatest gift ever on Christmas, that you have given us your son, Jesus, to save us from our sins. Thank you for forgiving our sins. And please keep us with you always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you guys for coming up. You guys go back to your pews. And I ask the congregation to sing the last two stanzas of our hymn. Let us begin our meditation of God's word with a prayer, the same one used by Simeon when he saw Jesus for the first time at the temple. We pray, Lord, you may now dismiss your servants in peace according to your word, because our eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people, Israel. Amen. And to you, my dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, our Lord, who receive by faith and hold on by faith God's gift that he has wrapped for you long ago. With Christmas comes wrapped gifts, doesn't it? It's just natural. Christmas time comes, and what you expect underneath the tree are wrapped gifts for you. And you like to open them, wouldn't you? Like to open those presents because you know what's inside of those presents is something that you'll enjoy. It's something your loved ones have thought about and given to you so that you could open it and like it. And so even though you know somewhat about the gift, or maybe you know more about it, that it's probably one of these several things, you don't know exactly what the gift is under the tree, because after all, it's wrapped. You just want to know, though. You want to know what's inside of those gifts. I mean, what's Christmas without a few wrapped gifts, right? And God, very early on, he wrapped the gift of salvation for you, for the world. It just took a little while for God's wrapped gift to be fully open. And Christmas, it has to be somewhat of the favorite time of, I would say, almost everyone, wouldn't you say? Especially for kids. Kids love Christmas time. I remember as a kid how excited I was for Christmas. I remember a lot around Christmas time. I remember setting up our family plastic tree that was over 10 years older than myself. I remember the Christmas services that I participated in as a kid, singing the hymns I've learned and saying the memory passages that I learned. I remember going to the candlelight service at my own church and all the other Christmas special services that I attended. I remember my family's traditions on Christmas Eve, and I certainly remember the wrapped gifts under the tree. I was so excited to open those gifts because I knew my parents would get me what I needed or something that I really wanted. And so I just wanted to know what was inside those presents. I didn't want to wait. And so, as a kid, I would do all I could to figure out what was inside a wrapped gift before I even opened it. Now, I wouldn't open it, but I would do almost everything else pretty much as a kid. And quite honestly, I still do this. You could ask my wife later, she'll agree. But what I would do, I would take the gift and I would feel the weight of it, shake it, see if it makes any noise. Sometimes even feel the texture of it, try and get the shape of it. And if there's raised edges and letters, my sister taught me a trick. You take a piece of paper, put it over it, and you shade it with a pencil, and you can usually read or see the symbol. I mean, I did almost anything you could short of opening the gift to figure out what was inside of my wrapped gifts. Oftentimes, I would guess right by that point. But not always, and I wouldn't exactly know what it is. I would still have to wait for Christmas Day to open my presents. I don't know if you're like me that tries all that you can to guess what it is before opening it. I mean, for me, that's just as much fun as opening it. Others, they like to open it just a little bit, peeling it back on Christmas, mind you, just slowly opening it, just enough to see what it is, and then ripping it open. Well, however you open up a wrapped gift, once it is open, you rejoice. You're happy. You enjoy that gift, and you use that gift. That's one of the reasons why Christmas is so loved by so many, is the opening of wrapped gifts. And God, He wrapped a gift for the whole world. He realized that the world was in dire need of a very special and important gift. A gift that everyone needs to have, even if they don't realize the necessity of this gift. God saw the world was sinful, which would make every person on earth sinful. There is the need to be saved from sin. And so God, very early on, He wrapped the gift of salvation. But it wasn't quite ready to open right away. The gift of salvation that God wrapped would have to wait to be opened fully on that first Christmas day. That's not to say people couldn't figure out what this gift was going to be before it was opened. The Old Testament prophecies was such that it was like feeling the weight, the texture of the gift, hearing the noises that came inside. Each prophecy was kind of like the ripping of the paper just a little bit. There's plenty of Old Testament prophecies that tells us about the salvation that was to be opened on Christmas. Such prophecies as He will crush the serpent's head and His ankle will be bruised. He'll be born of a virgin. He'll be born in Bethlehem. A little too much, I would say. He'll be descendant of David, of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He'll give sight to the blind. He'll cure the sick. He'll make the lame walk, sight to the blind. He'll preach to the poor. He'll be sold for 30 pieces of silver. He is the perfect sacrificial lamb of God that will take away the sins of the entire world. Each of these prophecies, and there's many more, the Old Testament's chock full of them, it's the ripping of that wrapping that God put around the gift of salvation. Each one making us realize, learning more about what this gift will fully be like. But it couldn't be fully open. Not until Christmas Day. On Christmas Day, Mary and Joseph, they arrived at Bethlehem. And they tried looking for a place to stay while they were there. It got later and later, but they couldn't find any room in any inn. And so Joseph and 9-month pregnant Mary had to stay where animals ate and slept. And on that night, God's gift of salvation was fully opened. Jesus was born on that day. Jesus was born the salvation of the world. Jesus. Salvation. Slept in a manger stall on Christmas Day. The gift on that day was fully open. No more needing to guess what this gift may be. Everyone could see what this gift is fully is, and it certainly had come onto the earth. Its salvation was here for all. And although salvation would be for all, it was first given to the Jews. The Jews were the first to experience and enjoy God's gift of salvation on earth. Such people as Mary and Joseph, the shepherds, Anna and Simon, who were at the temple, they were the first to see salvation. And then Jesus, He spent most of His ministry going through the regions of Galilee, Judea, Samaria. He spent most of His lifetime in those areas. But God's gift of salvation wasn't only for the Jews. God's gift of salvation is for all the earth. That's why the wise men came to celebrate the birth of Jesus, because God's gift of Jesus was for the wise men too. And especially after Jesus' ascension into heaven, God intended and God commanded for his gift of salvation to be shared with the surrounding nations, to be shared with all the earth. And it was probably your family or maybe a friend who shared God's gift of salvation with you for the first time. And to think that being separated by 2,000 years, separated by half a world, God's gift eventually made its way to you to be shared with you. God's gift was shared as your family member or your loved one shared Jesus with you, shared the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, who is for you. And as they shared God's gift of salvation, the Holy Spirit was working within you to give you faith. And so with the sharing of salvation, God has actually made you a Christian by faith. And it is by faith that you hang on to God's gift of salvation for your own. So God's salvation has become your salvation for yourself. It sounds a little confusing, I know. So let's unpack this gift a little bit more, piece by piece. God's gift is salvation from sin, death, and the devil. Your salvation can only be found in Christ Jesus, who, being 100% God and 100% man, lived, died, and won salvation for you. And then it is by faith that you receive salvation. Faith is like the arms, the hands that hold on to salvation near and dear to your heart. This gift is so great that we want to keep it for ourselves. We don't want to let go of it. But God's gift of salvation is so great that it can be shared with others. And God wants us to share it with others as well. God's gift of salvation has already been fully open for all of us. God's gift is salvation for us, found in Christ Jesus. And by faith, we hold on to this gift. This gift is the greatest gift we will ever have. It's a gift worth holding on to. It's a gift worth sharing with others. Amen. I ask that you please stand as we confess our faith together using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, we give our offerings to the Lord. Currently, we can give our offerings before or after our worship. You can give your offering in the place. But since this is a spiritual act of worship that we give back to God, He has given to us, we still sing, "To Thee My Heart I Offer." Continue by praying responsibly the prayer of the church. We do have a prayer request this morning on behalf of Pastor Raywert, who is the pastor in Trinity in Aberdeen. He has guest preached for us several times, especially during Lent. He has been admitted to the hospital for pneumonia that was brought on because of COVID-induced pneumonia. He is taken care of. Nurses are saying that he should be just fine, but still, we ask the Lord to please grant him a recovery and to be with him during this time of sickness. We pray. Eternal Father, throughout the centuries, you repeated and affirmed your promise to send the offspring of the woman to crush the serpent's head. Through your prophets of old, you continually directed the eyes of your people to the advent of their Savior. As we prepare to celebrate the birth of our King, use your mighty word to shatter our pride and to rouse us from spiritual slumber and apathy. You sent your Son to redeem us from sin. Let this good news be our joy and strength. Use it to cheer the lonely, encourage the fearful, and give hope to the despairing. In these days before Christmas, spare us from the stress of deadlines and the frenzy of commercialism. Direct our eyes not only to the manger, but also to the skies, where we will see your Son coming again, not as a lowly child, but as the Lord of Lords. Compassionate Father, in your mercy you transform even sickness and disease into a blessing for your children. With this confidence, we commit all who are sick or suffering to your tender care. We pray especially for Pastor Raywert. Provide healing and relief according to your infinite wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant patient endurance if his suffering must linger. Help him find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during this time of physical weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach him to trust in your forgiveness, grace, and love. In Jesus' name we pray. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Come quickly, Lord Jesus, in your grace, in your power, and in your glory.
Come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
And we join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. continue with the sacrament portion of our service. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Through his holy prophets, he promised a king to bring light to those living in darkness and in the shadow of death. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of your glory. You are my God, and I will exalt you. I will give you thanks, for you have become my salvation. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of your glory.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Oh, Christ, Lamb of God, you take away the sin.
You may be seated. A review of our communion practices. Right now, because of everything going on, we are just asking for a pew to come forward. We'll start on this side, start with the pew, receive the host, receive the cup, put it in the bowl, go back to your pew, then the next pew comes forward, and repeat the process until we get to the back, and then the back comes up forward there. Those up in the balcony can come forward at your discretion. Come, for the Lord's Supper is ready. Take also and drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for your forgiveness. Also and drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for your forgiveness.
Take also drink the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus.
our Lord's Supper, strengthen, preserve your faith, life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven. Go in peace and joy. Amen. Please stand for thanksgiving, prayer, and blessing.
Thank the Lord and sing His praise. Tell everyone what He has done. Let all see the Lord rejoice and proudly declare His name. He reveals His promises and leads His people forth in joy. Rich shouts of thanksgiving, alleluia, alleluia.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good.
And His mercy endures forever.
O God the Father, source of all goodness, in your loving kindness, you sent your Son to share our humanity. We thank you that through him you have given us pardon and peace in the sacrament. We also pray that you will not forsake us, but will rule our hearts and minds in your Holy Spirit, so that we willingly serve you day after day. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
You may be seated for the singing of our closing hymn, Let Us All With Gladsome Voice. Good morning once again. It was great to worship with you today. The announcements can be found in the insert of your bulletin or your worship folder, as well as a little picture of telling us what our next week's services will be like. The children's Christmas service, as I mentioned, that has been reduced to the children singing Away in the Manger, all three stanza as our closing hymn. But the rest of it would be the same lessons, same hymns that they should be familiar with. So the kids might sing louder that Sunday, regardless of being up here in front or not. It would be good to hear. But as you see, we're going to take a perspective of Christmas. On the children's Christmas service, we're going to take the perspective of Bethlehem, see what it was like for Mary and Joseph, for the Savior to be born in Bethlehem, and for the shepherds as well. Christmas Eve, we're going to take a little broader look at Scripture and see the perspective of Christmas for us, what it means that Scripture has been fulfilled from beginning to end. And then Christmas Day, the perspective from God, what it was like for, or what it would be like for God to give His only Son, His perspective on that day. So if you want to share that with others, if you want to share the link, that's fine. But that's what the picture is about. The only announcement I'd really like to highlight at this time, besides the special services, will be the council meeting after worship today.